Well, the Jaguar Drivers Club comes of age this year, but this car goes back much further than that, to the year 1937. It is the classic SS100, and the gentleman behind the wheel is one of the most distinguished names in the British motor industry, the man who started the whole thing, Sir William Lyons. Sir William, welcome. You started off making swallow sidecars, didn't you, for motorcycles?
That's so, yes.
How did the jump come about between that kind of very small piece of machinery and this magnificent sports car? What gave you the idea for it?
Well, of course, sidecars were very popular in those days, and it did provide us with a start in business. But I became impatient and felt that it was not sufficient to build up a business on sidecars alone, so we produced a number of bodies. We produced a body for the Austin 7, we call it the Austin Swallow, and then we were very successful at it. It sold very well indeed, and it established the company on its feet. We then went on to other models. We put a body on a standard chassis, and even that wasn't sufficient, and so we got our own chassis out and produced a body for our own chassis, and eventually then we produced the SS1, as we called it, SS1, which was the name was derived from Standard Swallow.
Right.
They called it Standard Swallow, but we called it the Swallow Special, you see. And that was quite successful. We enlarged the business from that stage. We did produce bodies on other chassis as well. But the SS1 was the basis on which we decided to promote our own car, our own name, our own individuality. We got into quite a reasonable production, and we then found that we hadn't sufficient room to produce the number required in our factory in Blackpool, so we moved to Coventry, and we enlarged, and we went on from there until eventually, say, this one was the start of inroads into high-performance cars. It was quite a high-performance car.
How competitive was it?
Well, it was very successful in the RAC rallies. We won quite a number of those, particularly in the final speed trials. We had some very good drivers, of course. I remember one occasion we had a fellow called Harrop, Jack Harrop, who unfortunately was killed during the war, but he was a very good driver, a very ingenious sort of chap, because I remember on one occasion on the Blackpool, strange enough, promenade, when they all started together and they did the Le Mans start, they had to run from a distance to the car. He outdid everybody else because he fixed a device to his car so that instead of having to press the button and turn the starter and so on, he just closed the door and the engine started and he was away yards before everybody else.
You should have offered that to the people at Le Mans.
Well, I think they were frightened that it mightn't work or something of the sort.
Now, I saw a car just like this the other day in a showroom, and they were asking £12,500 for it. What was the price when you made it?
I recall, I should think, about £450.
Now, that doesn't sound a lot of money, even for 1937. Was it an expensive car then?
No, we did seem to gain a reputation for making cars which were very reasonably priced.
How did you do it?
Well, I think it was because we ran the company efficiently and economically. We didn't throw money about, and I think we managed to get the goodwill and the support of the workers. I remember when we started with the Austin Swallow originally, we had tremendous enthusiasm. We used to work until late at night to get out the number. We'd say we wanted to produce 10 in a day, and they would all work until they were done. You know, we had the right spirit. It was very good in those days.
Well, the SS100 will go down through the ages as one of the best-looking classic sports cars of all time. But I'd like you now, if you will, to come with me and have a look at what I think is quite a different kind of Jaguar.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I will, certainly.
Well, Sir William, the car I had in mind was this, the Mark 7, which in fact came out in 1950. Now, surely nothing could be further from the tradition of sporting cars and performance than this, which is a large luxury car.
Oh, well, it proved to be very effective in competitions. In fact, Cyril Vard won the Monte Carlo Rally with it, which was quite something for a car of this type.
So it was designed to have performance, in fact?
It certainly was designed to have performance. And, of course, it had been proved by its predecessor, the one we brought out to try out the engine.
Ah, now you are, of course, referring to the classic Jaguar, perhaps of all time, aren't you?
That is so.
Let's go and have a look at it.
The XK120, yes.
Well, this, of course, Sir William, is, as I said, the classic Jaguar, the XK120. How did it get its name?
The XK120, well, of course, the XK was the name that we used for all the drawing references. And the 120 was what we imagined it could possibly do in speed.
Did you try it out?
Yes, we did a lot of testing with it. It was originally, of course, intended as a test bed. And we tried it out, and we did actually fine. We had a fellow, we called him Soapy Sutton. He was a very good driver and very good. And apparently he went out one morning and on the Vista Strait, which is before the 70 mile an hour limit. Well, I think that the 120 mile an hour he achieved was rather more than would have been permitted by the police. But however, he came back one morning and said that he'd exceeded 120, so we were very happy about that. And then, of course, afterwards, we decided that we would take it over to Belgium and give it a run on the Debacker Road. And we invited all the press to come with us. When I say all the press, the representatives of the most popular papers. And we took them over into Dakota, and Sutton drove the car. And it exceeded 132 miles an hour.
Which was astonishing.
It really was. We were astonished too.
Now, you said, of course, it was a test bed. The idea then, although you hoped it might sell as a two-seater sports car, was really to test components for the Mark 7.
We had got this engine well advanced, this new XK engine with the twin overhead camshaft, hemispherical head, and this provided a quick opportunity to try it out. So we made this very, very quickly. In fact, the design was pretty well settled in about 3 days. And I think we had the car on the road within 3 months of the start. And it did actually, in fact, give us the evidence we wanted as to the suitability of this engine, which, of course, was intended for the, shall we say, bread and butter car. That's the Mark the Mark 7, which we had already got on paper. And we put that engine into that car, of course, and as you've already been told, it was very successful, even in competition. It had a very high performance, very good indeed.
Well, let's move on and move up the years to Jaguar's most recent bread and butter car, shall we say, although I fancy it would be quite an expensive loaf.
Yes, that's right.
Well, Sir William, let's move on now and have a look at Leyland Jaguar's latest bread and butter car, although I dare say the loaf is a bit more expensive. The XJ series, with which you were also intimately involved. Now, I've been told that this is your favourite of all the Jaguars. What is it about the XJ series Jaguars that is so appealing to you?
Well, of course, if one can't improve on what one has done before, it's unfortunate, isn't it? And so each one has been better than the other, I think. So this was the last one, and therefore it should be the best, shouldn't it? Well, I think the particular attractive part of this car is that it has all amenities. It has the accommodation one requires. It's a very quiet car. That is one outstanding thing which it has. And it has a very smooth and powerful engine, and the performance is unquestionable. And the general lines of the thing seem to appeal to people. And I think that is the best the most important characteristics of this car.
Now, you've told me that the XK120 took really only 3 days to produce a finished design. I bet it took a bit longer with this.
Ah, yes. This, of course, I should think took 3 years, not 3 days.
But you're particularly pleased, aren't you, with some of the details of this car?
No, I think as a whole, it all conforms to what I like. But there are some details which gave more problems than others. I quite agree. I know we had a lot of trouble with the back end. When I say a lot of trouble, I should think we must have made at least 6 or 7 back ends before we got the one that looked right.
And now it is, as the engineer would say, proper.
That's a very good way of putting it, yes, I agree.
Sir William Lyons, thank you very much indeed.